بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه أستعين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين. Dear students, today inshallah we are going to talk about synthetic dopaminergics, also called adrenergic drugs. We will start with just giving a little introduction about the sympathetic nervous system and the biosynthesis of catecholamines. This is our goal, to understand how this sympathetic nervous system, this wonderful miracle from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can prepare us for what's called fight or flight response. And then we will end up with the catecholamine synthesis and release. So first, sympathetic nervous system. We talked before about these divisions of autonomic nervous system, sympathetic nervous system, and parasympathetic nervous system. We said about parasympathetic nervous system is referred to as rest and digest. However, sympathetic nervous system is referred to as fight or flight. It prepares the human being or the animal into a fight or flight or stressful situation. Okay, and by the way, the body of our brain does not differentiate between dangerous situation and stressful situation. So we are always recommended to do what's called stress management to minimize the overstress and the subsequent complications. So it prepares the body for emergency situations. Heart rate will increase. All what you need, everything you need for this fight or flight response, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide you with. So what do you need? If you need for flight or flight response, or also adjusting during exercise, what do you need? You need the heart rate to increase. Yes, because I need to pump more blood to the tissues, specifically into the skeletal muscle and to the lung also for exchange of gas. What else you need? You need breathing to be rapid. Yes, there is no heart rate, increasing heart rate without increasing the breathing rate. And also this breathing will be deep, so it will allow for more efficient gas exchange. This is one of the wonderful miracles of the sympathetic nervous system. It works on the blood vessels in almost an opposite way. So in the it's kind of recruiting or diverting the blood supply into the skeletal muscle. So it's kind of saying to the viscera and skin guys, can you do you mind if I take some blood from you and give it to the most urgently needing organ, which is the skeletal muscle. This is what happened exactly. This one here, blood flow to organs, including the skin, includes alpha receptors, so they will undergo vasoconstriction. And here, this it has beta receptor. This will have vasodilation. This will ensure skeletal muscle specifically, will receive enough blood supply to carry out whatever it needs to do. So here is like a nice cartoon about someone under very stressed situation. If you take it from up down, okay, so what do you need during the stress situation? Do you need meiosis or midriasis? You need midriasis, right? So you watch your enemy, you prepare yourself for any knock, for any whatever, okay? If anything happens, you are very prepared to. In the CNS, there is CNS, some stimulation and some alertness. On the bronchi, there is a bronchodilatation. You need this. Heart rate increase. Force of contraction itself will increase. Blood pressure will increase. To ensure, all of these will ensure blood will go to the urgent organ, including the skeletal muscle. And this blood should be oxygenated. Okay, so it will go to the lung to be oxygenated. So it is will provide these organs with oxygenated blood. Along blood also will carry the nutrients, including glucose. Right on the level of the skin, there is some perspiration. It's cholinergic because we know that the sweat gland is sympathetic cholinergic. Do you remember? So the nerve is sympathetic, but releases at the end acetylcholine and acetylmascarin. Saliva will be just little and viscous. On the fat, okay, in the fat, there is an increase in lipolysis, fatty acid liberation. So now these fats will be used for the gluconeogenesis and because the skeletal muscle needs more blood flow, will give you more blood flow. So there is vasodilation. And there is glycogenolysis inside the skeletal muscle. Glycogenolysis will convert glycogen into glucose, in addition to gluconeogenesis, which will use these fats. Okay, the liver will increase, will do the glycogenolysis also, and gluconeogenesis, which will provide glucose from non-carbohydrate source, including fats. And the GIT, there will be decrease in peristaltic movement, and there is increase in sphincter tone. You don't like during this stress response, during fight or flight, to go to the toilet, right? You're not going to do urination or defecation during this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared you for these stressful situations. So there is no need to go to the toilet. And the blood flow here will decrease because we need to ensure more blood supply go to the skeletal muscle. This kind of summarizes what I said. Now, pupils will dilate because of the contraction of the dilator pupillary muscle. Okay, in the parasympathetic nervous system, we say constrictor pupillary muscle, or pupillary dilator muscle, or dilator pupillary muscle. And the liver and bronchi will dilate, enabling alveolar oxygen uptake to be increased. This is what we need. Okay. This actually is not due to the sympathetic innervation, but due to the release of adrenaline from adrenal medulla, which will activate beta 2 receptors in the lung. The heart rate will increase and the force of contraction, so the pumping efficacy will be high also. Blood vessels, as we said, the sympathetic nervous system will divert blood from the skin and the viscera to go to the skeletal muscle where it's more needed. Okay. On the level of the GIT and renal tract, we see relaxation of the aorta, constriction of the sphincter, salivary gland, little secretion, and sweating. We said there is some little increased sweating. Blood sugar will increase due to glycogenolysis, breakdown of glycogen into glucose, and gluconeogenesis, formation of or synthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate source, which is coming mainly from the lipolysis of the adipose tissue, providing more fats that could be used and fuel this gluconeogenesis. Here you see even in animals, when they are nervous, they are preparing to attack or being attacked, you see this hair erection. And on the level of the male sex organ, you see ejaculation as compared to erection in the parasympathetic nervous system. The neurohormones here are mainly norepinephrine and epinephrine, in addition to acetylcholine, which goes from the preganglionic to the postganglionic, as we explained before, everywhere, right? In everything, we said all autonomic ganglia have acetylcholine and the receptor is nicotinic, if you remember. And the postganglionic neuron here releases norepinephrine. Okay? And in addition, epinephrine itself is secreted by the adrenal medulla. And norepinephrine is secreted by the nerve ending of the sympathetic or also called adrenergic nerve fiber. This little cartoon just walks you over the sympathetic ganglionic synapse. If you look here, they look here, action potential, sodium, and then influx of calcium will facilitate the release of acetylcholine. And the acetylcholine will be released in the synapse and activate postganglionic neuron. Again, this is preganglionic neuron, and this is postganglionic neuron. So this is the ganglia here. It's exactly a copy of what we have seen in the parasympathetic nervous system. No change, okay? Then continue. Consider that the coming slide is kind of continuous from here, okay? So it's just following this one will be postganglionic neuron, the part that was from the previous slide. Okay, and it's coming here again, action potential. And here, calcium will be influxed and will be inserted. And calcium will facilitate the release of norepinephrine. Here in the postganglionic neuron, it will release norepinephrine. There in the parasympathetic nervous system, it was acetylcholine. This will work on the adrenergic receptor, which is G protein coupled receptor. In the previous one, just if I forgot, it was ligand against ion channel. So again, let me recap this part. So now action potential, calcium influx, facilitation of release of acetylcholine from the nerve ending into the synapse. Acetylcholine will activate the nicotinic receptor. If it's ganglia, this ganglia, it will be NN receptor. Okay. But this here is nicotinic receptor. It's ligand gate ion channel, which means upon the binding of acetylcholine to this receptor, there will be influx of sodium. Sodium will, you know, initiate action potential continuous. Okay, sodium, potassium, and then calcium influx, facilitation of the release of norepinephrine. This is the difference here, and that's here on adrenergic receptor. Okay. And this adrenergic receptor, we said before, all adrenergic receptors are G protein coupled receptors. Okay. Let us go into more details about this noradrenergic neurotransmitter, how this norepinephrine is synthesized, how epinephrine is synthesized. Let's start from the beginning, from this hydroxylated amino acid tyrosine. Okay. Will be transported into the nerve, noradrenergic nerve ending by sodium dependent carrier. It's called carrier A. That's almost similar to what we have seen in the parasympathetic nervous system. Tyrosine now is inside the nerve terminal. This tyrosine, under the effect of tyrosine hydroxylase, will add hydroxyl group to this tyrosine. Tyrosine will be converted into DOPA. Then it will be converted by enzyme called DOPA decarboxylase. We'll see this later. It's converted into dopamine. Dopamine will be transferred into the vesicle by carrier B. Okay, so here carrier A, carrier B. So if you go sequentially, it's easy. A, B. Okay, so this comes before this. This carrier B is brought by the glycosylated beam. It transports other like norepinephrine, ATP, and dopamine inside this synaptic vesicle is converted into norepinephrine. Okay, and then norepinephrine itself, okay, will be released, but under the effect of action potential coming, as we said before, is coming action potential, sodium, potassium. Okay, sodium here, and then calcium influx. Calcium will facilitate the release of the fusion of this synaptic vesicle with the nerve terminal and membrane, okay, and the release of norepinephrine, okay, and some of the other co-transmitters, ATP, phosphate. This norepinephrine now has like about four choices. Number one, this is what we need actually, is for it to activate the postsynaptic receptor, whether it is alpha, beta, whatever, okay, alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2. Receptors. This is scenario number one. Number two, diffusion to the blood. Number three, uptake back into the nerve terminal from which it came, right? And then uptake into the postsynaptic cell. Uptake two. So uptake one, uptake two. So again, division of the receptor, diffusion, uptake one, uptake two. Okay. Another thing here is autoreceptor. If it binds to autoreceptor, okay, there's heteroreceptor also. So it binds to autoreceptor, it will inhibit further release of norepinephrine. Okay, heteroreceptors, it's like effect of other neurotransmitter hormone on this one. This sequence of events can continue to another one more event or less. One event. How? In the adrenal medulla. The synthesis is carried out one step further by enzyme phenyl ethanolamine N-limethyl transferase, which converts norepinephrine into epinephrine. Okay, we'll talk about this in the coming slide. That's why the adrenal medulla contains about 80% adrenaline. It's adrenal medulla. Adrenaline. Easy, right? Adrenal medulla. Adrenaline. Good mnemonic. And about 20% only from is noradrenaline. From where noradrenaline comes, it comes from the nerve endings. However, on the dopaminergic neurons, the synthesis terminates with dopamine. Do you remember? We said tyrosine, dopamine, that's it, in the dopaminergic neuron. It's not going to convert it into norepinephrine. So again, to summarize this one, there the whole synthetic pathway, tyrosine, this is tyrosine, this is hydroxylated amino acid, this hydroxyl. Under the effect of the enzyme tyrosine, hydroxylase, tyrosine, I added one hydroxyl group here, okay. Then under, so it's converted into DOPA, and then under the effect of DOPA decarboxylase, this will remove this carboxyl group. So it will be dopamine. And then dopamine under the effect of beta hydroxylase, this is the amino group, this alpha carbon, and this is the beta carbon. Dopamine hydroxylase will add hydroxyl group onto the beta carbon, so it will be converted into noradrenaline, also called norepinephrine. In the adrenal medulla, this occurs in the adrenal medulla, okay, that this enzyme phenylethanolamine, this is phenylethanolamine, okay, and the methyl transferase, they add a methyl group into this nitrogen, so this one is now adrenaline. By the way, chemically, nor in chemistry means dimethyl. So adrenaline here, if you remove the methyl group, it is noradrenaline. Okay, that's it for today. Thank you so much for attention. See you inshallah later. Please enjoy and say subhanallah wa alhamdulillah. Subhanallah al-azim. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.